Hey guys, it's Greg with Apple Explained, and today I am a little sick, so I apologize if my voice sounds a little nasally or raspy, but this video is really exciting because we're going to explore the story behind the iPhone X's gesture interface. Now, this may seem like a fairly straightforward topic, but creating a gesture-based interface that feels natural is actually very complex and requires an understanding of how humans perceive fluidity when interacting with a touch-based operating system. Now, this topic was the second place winner of last week's voting poll, and if you didn't get to vote, make sure you're subscribed. That way the voting polls will show up right in your mobile activity feed and you can let me know which video you'd like to see next. Now before we begin, I want you guys to know that this video is essentially a summary of everything I learned from this session at the 2018 Worldwide Developers Conference, and I highly recommend watching it if you have the time, so I'll leave a link to that video in the description. So when Apple decided to remove the home button starting with the iPhone X, it posed a problem. How would users navigate iOS? How could Apple make that navigation experience even better than what the classic home button offered? Because the home button has been a signature feature of the iPhone since its introduction in 2007, and the home button eventually adopted much more functionality than simply returning you to the home screen from wherever you're at. It eventually was capable of unlocking your phone with Touch ID, helping to take screenshots, triggering multitasking with a double click, summoning Siri with a long press, and even activating accessibility features like reachability with a double tap. So with all this new functionality in a single button, removing it raises a lot of questions. Namely, how will Apple incorporate all of these capabilities into a strictly gesture-based operating system? So let's explore exactly how they did it. Apple actually delegated the responsibilities of the home button to not only operating system gestures, but also to other physical buttons the iPhone already had. Touch ID was replaced by Face ID, the side button helped take screenshots, multitasking was triggered by a specific gesture, Siri was now triggered through a long press on the side button, and reachability could be activated with its own gesture. Now, as you can see, these were a lot of changes Apple had to make simply from removing the home button, and that meant users had to fundamentally relearn a number of features that they had been using for years. But Apple did their best to take advantage of users' existing muscle memory by mirroring feature activation on the iPhone X as closely to previous iPhones as possible, because Siri was still activated by a long button press, screenshots were still taken by pressing two buttons simultaneously, and your iPhone could be unlocked securely with just a glance, requiring virtually zero user interaction. But that wasn't even the hardest part in developing the iPhone's gesture-based operating system. The biggest challenge Apple faced was ensuring the operating system felt natural, like an extension of your hand. Because your finger would be interacting with every element of the operating system, and those gestures had to be as or even more responsive than a physical home button, which is difficult since other gesture-based operating systems are known for being sluggish, clunky, and just frustrating. So what did Apple have to consider to ensure the iPhone X's interface was as fluid as possible? Well, there's three major elements that needed to be optimized: the operating system's lag time, lightweight gesture detection, and the ability to overlap gestures. And if these three elements can be perfected, the user's experience in interacting with their phone becomes incredibly quick, effortless, and even enjoyable. So let's start with the ability to overlap gestures, which is probably one of the most important features when trying to make the operating system feel fast. Let's say you're in the middle of opening an app when you decide that you actually want to access multitasking instead. So you swipe up and are able to summon multitasking while the app is in the middle of opening. So with iOS, you can actually interrupt an action with another while still maintaining the same fluidity as a complete uninterrupted action. Now this may appear to be an insignificant capability, but it's critical in ensuring the operating system keeps up with the speed of your thoughts, allowing you to change your mind in the middle of a gesture. Because imagine how annoying it'd be to have to follow through with every gesture you begin, and executing another gesture to undo that action, and then navigating to where you actually wanted to go in the first place. So the technology that allows this feature is actually pretty impressive. Because while you may assume a touchscreen interface only needs to recognize vertical and horizontal movements, a fluid gestural interface requires multi-axis sensing, therefore enabling overlapping gestures. That way your device responds to your stream of thoughts and actions, rather than you having to adjust your workflow to your device's limited capabilities. This also means you can discover new gestures while executing existing ones. Because as you're swiping up to go home, you might discover the multitasking feature along the way. And this is all critical to ensuring the operating system feels like it's responding to you instantly. And on that note, let's talk about latency or lag time. Every iPhone has been known for being responsive, but it's much more difficult for an operating system to respond to an ambiguous gesture than a straightforward button press. So how do you accomplish this type of interface? Some people might assume Apple uses a timer. For example, waiting to trigger multitasking until your finger travels below a certain speed for a certain amount of time. But it turns out that creates a significant lag, which is frustrating for users. So how does iOS anticipate your desire to trigger multitasking before your finger even stops moving? Well, it turns out tracking the acceleration of your finger as it's moving up allows iOS to anticipate the pause that will trigger multitasking, allowing the multitasking pages to appear almost as soon as you think about it, instead of waiting for them to appear after your finger has already stopped moving. Because by that point, your mind has already moved on to the next task it wants to accomplish. Another important characteristic of a fluid operating system is detecting lightweight interactions. This is what enables effortless swipes, scrolls, and responsive taps. But what is a lightweight interaction? Essentially, it means the operating system can respond dramatically to the slightest and smallest of gestures, meaning you can accomplish more with less finger motion. And it all begins with iOS understanding as much about your short gesture as possible to calculate the energy and momentum needed to deliver an appropriate software response. And these calculations include your finger's position, velocity, speed, and force, which generates a fluid amplification of your movement. And this allows your gestures to feel like an extension of your hand. For example, when you scroll through a page, your finger is only on the screen for a very brief amount of time, but the operating system can calculate the correct momentum and speed of your gesture and allow the page to scroll in a way that feels natural. And if you remember back to the original iPhone, Steve Jobs demonstrated this feature, which is called inertial scrolling. And it was a really big deal at the time, because no other phone company had incorporated this feature into their operating system. Instead, the phone would only scroll when your finger was moving across the screen. Once your finger was no longer in contact with the display, it would stop scrolling abruptly, which meant users had to make long, strenuous gestures to scroll down something like a web page. And when it comes to the iPhone X, the home screen gesture operated in a very similar way. But one aspect of this gesture that some people may not consider is that you're still using the same muscle memory from pressing a physical home button, because your thumb still travels to the bottom of the display to begin the home screen gesture, which is where the old home button used to be. And this is an important consideration since it makes transitioning to the iPhone X's gestural interface more natural. Now, when it comes to making the operating system feel smooth and fluid, you may assume it all has to do with the frame rate, but that isn't necessarily the case, because if a movement is not optimized to appear fluid, it will likely look choppy even at a high frame rate. For example, even at 30 frames per second, a movement can appear very smooth due to minimal differences between each frame and other tricks like motion blur and motion stretching. And you can see this in action when launching an app on the iPhone X, because as it stretches to take over the display, Apple actually added slight blurring between each frame to give your eye extra information to perceive the motion as fluid. But Apple didn't only consider how smooth movements appeared, but also how heavy they felt. For example, when you swipe between photos, it takes an effortless flick, because Apple wanted the photos to feel light. But when swiping between apps, it takes a more deliberate drag, since apps are conceptually heavier than photos. And although you may not have noticed this difference consciously, its inclusion enables a more natural interaction with your phone, Because maybe if iOS didn't include these small details, your overall experience with the operating system would feel less natural. Now today, this gesture-based operating system that began with the iPhone X is now used by the iPhone XS, XS Max, and XR. So it's clear that this approach is the future of the iPhone and likely every other smartphone on the market. And I think this is definitely the right direction, because once you become acclimated to the changes made to iOS, navigating your iPhone with gestures is at least twice as fast than a physical home button. And this is only the beginning. I'm very excited to see what other ideas Apple has in store for this type of interface, especially when it comes to the iPad. So that was the story behind iPhone X's gesture interface, and if you want to vote for the next video topic, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.